So the issue with this, with the design is that we build on a single system. It's a four factor. So there's data from 16 experiments on this four factors. And I'm not going to go through any of the stuff. That's all on the tutorial. But I'm going to just talk about how to set up the treatment. So, correspond to the intercept will be the first column in the X matrix, this will be column 2, column 3, and maybe this will be column 10, and that will be column 12. Hypothetically, I'm not sure what it is. So create a subset vector that will just extract those columns from X from R. Okay? And then you can pull out the relevant coefficients from the matrix B, vector B and matrix X. So you can say X dot sub is equal to X. And then you use this notation in R where you say comma, which just says take all the rows, comma, which column sub dot index. Okay. If you were using MATLAB, you would use something of the form X. Colon, comma, and then the vector of indices to pull that using that value. But in R, they don't use a colon operator, it's just comma and then sub up in here. So you'll get then a matrix X, which is now 16 by 5. And you can do the same for vector B dot sub is equal to B. But because B is a vector, you don't need that comma anymore, you just say sub dot index. Okay, and now you have appropriately sized matrices to compute Y at. That sort of notation is calculated by hat, and then from there you get the errors, and then you can calculate the standard error from that. Okay? So that would be the how you calculate the standard error and confirm that those effects are significant. We've also been for each of the coefficients. So is that clear for question? Okay, question four is then asking you to look at a half fraction. So I'm going to treat this as a revision for last week, and then we'll move on to a new one. So in question four, we were looking at a half fraction. We have factors A, B, C, and E. So a full factorial would be 16 minus. But a half fraction would be 8. So which 8 do you choose? There's 8 runs. So 8 runs means we have a full factorial in 3 factors over there. So the easiest way to think of this is just to write down A, B, and C, then your first 3 factors, and write a full factorial in those to generate those 8 experiments, and then we'll think of how to generate D. So minus plus, in standard order, and then you're D with D. C. Okay. Generating column D. We use the idea that you're confounded with the largest interaction that you're not interested in. Typically, it would be the 3-factor interaction. So it's very likely that ABC is not of any interest to us. However, in other experiments where this is your own system, ABC might be of interest, but you know then that BC interaction is non-existent. There's certain cases where you know already that 2-factor interactions are non-existent. So you could choose to confound the half fraction with any interaction term. But for typical cases where we have no knowledge, we choose the highest interaction possible. So D equals ABC would generate minus. So then you can extract from the full set of experiments, because we do actually have the full 16 runs in this assignment. So you can go then and extract the relevant rows from the full 16 runs that correspond to this design matrix. And then from that, calculate your vector B. Okay. So I'll leave it up to you to figure out which element B is confounded with. You would use obviously that D equals A B C, and that I equals A B C D as your defining relationship, and then you can compute the aliasing structure or confounding pattern for this experiment. Do you want me to go over that just as a recap from last time? Is it pretty self-explanatory? Okay, great. And then, so that could be question 5. Question 6, you report those numeric values and you compare them to the full factorial. Okay, so that's pretty much the whole assignment. So if you feel like you want to take your assignment submission back and you hand it in tomorrow at noon, just hand drop it in by the chemist box by noon tomorrow, so you can take some extra time to complete that assignment. Okay, any other questions from last week? This concept of running fewer runs than what we need to. So the concept of fractionation. When we have experiments with four or five variables, so like I will go over in a few minutes to look at some ideas related to the course project, you may have identified five, six factors that are of interest. But running a full factorial in all of those factors is prohibitive in many situations, from a time point of view as well as money. So we're looking at this idea of running a half fraction. Now we're going to look at further reduction in the size of the factorial. And the whole purpose of this section is to look at what you lose by using fewer and fewer experiments. We've already seen when we run a half fraction, we start confounding our main effects with three-factor interactions, and sometimes small experiments get confounding two factors. But what happens as we go further and further? So let's take a look at that. So in your notes, this would be page 26 or so. High-impact chain design, section 9.5. Okay, so the idea is we've got a 2 to the k factorial, and we want to run a subset of those, so 2 to the k minus p. And I give an example there. Say you have a budget of 8 experiments. How do you choose to spend that budget? That's typically the way we approach these problems, is not by saying you've got 5 factors and then how many experiments you run. It's usually the other way around. We have a fixed budget to allocate towards a certain number of experiments, and it's often constrained by time. So one can figure out how many experiments we can run. So it's typically going to be 4, 8, 16, some multiple to the power of 2 number of experiments. Once you've identified that, so in this case we're looking at 8, is what can we do with 8 experiments? At the end I'm going to talk about how can we maybe deal with 20 experiments, 24 experiments. But for now let's just deal with this case where k and p are integers. So a 2 to the 3 factorial is obviously, you've got 3 factors to investigate. And then 2 to the 4 minus 1 is a half fraction. That's what the sample was. So there's 4 factors, half fraction. And a 2 to the 5 minus 2 factorial would be 4, 5 factors. And we'll call this a quarter fraction, and so on. So we're investigating 5 factors in 8 experiments. So think of that, there's 5 main effects plus some number of 2-factor and 3-factor interactions. We can only estimate 8 parameters. So we definitely want to at least get the 5 main effects. So there's a bit of leeway there still. 2 to the 6 minus 3. System is obviously 6 factors, and then 2 to the 7 minus 4 is the smallest number of experiments you can do to investigate 7 factors. So the 7 factors, yeah. 8 parameters that you will investigate or compute. And that will be the 7 main effects. And I'll just write here, so it's confounded, very heavily confounded, and that's what we're going to look at now. Plus the intercept. So that's the lowest we can go, is 7 factors. And that's where we start off with when we're screening. if you're put in charge of a new chemical process, there's very quickly you'll be able to identify seven factors. You get a group of people together, seven opinions will quickly arise about which are the most important variables that affect the process. So this is a great way to inexpensively, a few number of runs, get to the bottom of which factors really are important. It's also very useful for lab scale work. You're developing a new product, for example, in the lab. Maybe it's something that you've been producing in the past, but now you're tweaking the formulation of it based on demands from customers. And you're not quite sure where to start. Where do you start modifying the process or the system? So this is a great way to figure that out. Another place where it's used is for product transfer. It's very common that products that are produced, for example, in Calgary, get moved over to Sarnia. And how do they transfer that to the Sarnia plant? It's not just a straight match of the settings that is currently used in Calgary. You need to modify what those settings are. It's not just that you set all your set points identically the same. The equipment's different, the environment is different. So this is where we start off with very often, is these very highly saturated designs. Okay. How do we set this design up? Well, with eight factors, we've got, eight runs is a 2 to the 3 is the full factorial. So we can assign, I'm going to look at this case with seven factors. I'm going to use this as an example. And it's going to, we'll assign A, B, and C to those three factors. So in the usual manner, minus plus. Now, how do you assign D, E, F, and G? Allocate experimental settings. So already in the first run we will run A and B and C at their low levels. D, E, F, and G, we typically
I think like for example D would be A, B, and E would be B, C, and F, A, C, and G, A, B, C.
A, B, C, perfect, yeah. So and that's for the 7-run case. There are only three so there's 3 2-factor interactions, and there's a 3-factor interaction. So there's enough interactions to allocate to E, E, F, and G. When it comes to the system with 6 factors, for example, you have some choice. There'll be some 2-factor interactions that you don't need to assign. But for these very highly saturated designs, when you run many factors in fewer experiments, you'll typically use up all your 2-factor and 3-factor interactions and have to assign them to the remaining variables. So let's generate variable D by saying that's A, E, I'll just keep this as A, C, F, B, C, and G is the 3-factor interaction. So you can go write that out. So the first one, A, B, is the plus, minus, and so on. And I won't repeat the rest of the table. It's all in notes. Okay? So we'll call these generators. We're generating D, E, F, and G from these 2-factor interactions. And if we write them, remember last week we showed a notation to deal with these. We can write that D is equal to AB. We can go multiply both sides by D. This is equal to I, based on the rules we established last week. So I is equal to ABD. In a similar way for variable E, and G, we can get A, B, C, G. So these four generators, when we write them in this way, I equals A, B, C, D, A, B, D, A, C, E, we call these words. OK? Okay? When we write them in the form of I equals ternary focal words. And these are defining relations. This defines how we establish the experiments in terms of variable D, T, F, and G. So these are defining relations. And the rule in general is for 2 to the k minus p vectorial system that there will be p generators. That's obvious because if we every time we're reducing the experiment by p, we have to generate that factor p in some way. So there will always be p generators. Okay? And there will be 2 to the p words. 2 to the p words in the defining relation. And I'll take a look at that now. So in this system with p equals 4, that's going to be 2 to the 4 equals 16 words. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4 words right now. There's a word that always equals I equals I. That's our fifth word. And I'll show how to generate the other words in a minute. There's the defining relationship. So we generate those by taking all possible combinations of the generators. So the complete defining relationship is found by taking every possible permutation of these four generators. So we'll do two at a time, ABE and ACE. So recalling the rules, AA cancels out, and that means we're left with BDCE. The second combination is ABD and ACE and ECF. So again, B's cancel out and we're left with AF. So we'll take 1 and 3, ABD and ECF. So A is cancelled out, B is cancelled out. So that's B, C, and G. And then I show a few others in the notes there. I'll just write them down here. A, B, E, F. This is on page 27. B, G, G. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 extra words obtained by taking these others. So we've got 5 plus 1, that's 6 now. We need to get up to 16. So then we can take the three combinations at a time, ABD, ACE, and BCF, and we can work through all of that and figure and see for yourself how that gets you to G. Next one is AD. And then the final one, the four factors all together give you A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Okay, so we've got an additional 1, 2, 3, 4 plus 5. Okay, so we've got 11, 12, and then So the reason why I'm going through this is just to kind of show you, it's a little bit tedious to do this, but where we're aiming at is to figure out what the aliasing structure is. And the way we do that, once we have the complete defining relationship now, we have 16 words, let's take a look at what the aliasing structure is for A. A is going to be alias or confounded word. Every one of these 16 words we're going to multiply by A. So take the first one there, is I is equal to BD. We multiply that by A. So we say A times ABD. So A is going to be confounded with BD plus ACE. A times BCF is, okay? And so on. You can keep writing this all out. There's going to be all these terms. terms here, 16 of them. No need to go through that, but it's printed at the bottom of page 27. The key point I want to make from this is that A is confounded with about 15 other terms. So when you're estimating the main effects from the system, the parameter that you estimate up here, remember we're going to get eight parameters in our vector B. The first entry in vector B is going to be related to main effect A. But we're really not estimating A, we're estimating A plus BD plus CD plus all these higher order interactions. So that's the price you're paying. Instead of running 2 to the 7 experiments and being able to estimate each one of these main effects factors separately, we're estimating only 8 parameters, but there's this incredible degree of confounding. So that's the trade we face by running these few number of experiments. And in particular, in this case, A is confounded with 2-factor interactions, and then 3- and 4-factor interactions. And from this point onwards, I'm probably just drop out the 3-factor interactions and higher. We're really just always assuming to be 0. And we focus mainly on the 2-factor and main effects. So in this situation, A will be confounded with BD plus CE, and there's in fact another 2-factor interaction in this list. And then you can compute that structure for the other main effects, which is now on page 28, right on the top third. There I show what the main effects are confounded with. Okay, so the other reason why we do this is when we write out these experiments, we know that A, B, C, D, E, F, and G might be pH, concentration, temperature, catalyst, mixing speed, and so on. Then but what we typically do is we don't assign A equals to pH and B equals to temperature and so on ahead of time. We just write about in this generic fashion, and then we see that, okay, had we assigned A to pH, it would be confounded with temperature and concentration, agitation speed, and another variable. And then we can decide, okay, well, wait, hang on. We know that A is going to be, that A, being temperature, is expected to be confounded, is important, but we don't want to confound it with the 2-factor interaction that we know about. So then we just reshuffle what we assign to A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. Okay? So write this out first, and then see what the trial system would look like, and you can maybe reassign the vectors based on which 2-factor interactions you want to avoid compounding. So you would then go actually and intentionally choose 2-factor interactions that you might know are non-existent and assign them to a main effect that you think might be important. So you might know that B is temperature and D is pH, that there's no interaction between temperature and pH. That means that you'll free up A to be a pretty good estimate of whatever the main effect you assign to A. Okay. So that's the approach we take then. There's a second example on page 28. This is a 2 to the 8 minus 5 system. It's also in 8 runs. Sorry, no, 2 to the 8 minus 4. Yeah. So the question is one of, how do you know before even running the experiment that what will you be getting out from this experiment, right? I think you're asking, like, how can we be sure that factor A that we might be interested in is not going to be so confounded with all these others? Or conversely, how, with what degree of accuracy are we going to estimate A? George Box, in the book there, makes an excellent statement, and I put it in the notes somewhere, is that the best time to run an experiment is after an experiment. ahead of the experiment, like you said, you don't know. So that means the worst time to run an experiment is before the experiment. The converse is the best time to run an experiment is after the experiment. So then he makes the other observation is don't spend more than 20-25% of your budget planning and doing experiments. He says use only up to 10-20% of your time and get going with that first experiment so that you can get some preliminary results and start to analyze and then figure out what to focus on. So don't spend your whole experimental budget doing an elaborate experiment in 32 runs. And then you find that so many effects are actually not significant. Rather run fewer runs in many factors, get all this confounding, and then I'll show next year how do we undo some of this confounding later on. So say you find that A is interesting. A has got a large significant, but you know, okay, well, is it due to A or is it due to B or C, D or F, G? What can you then do next to improve the way that A is? So I'll get to that in a minute. So the thing is not to delay and plan a huge experiment that's going to uncover all the main effects of two-factor interactions. Just get going with a very, very highly saturated, and we'll come to what that means, get to a very highly saturated design. Small number of runs, large number of factors. Get started with that, find the main effects, and then do additional runs. Experimenting is not a one-shot thing that you get it right the first time. You'll do it, and then do some more, and then do some more. That's what this whole class is today about, this whole sequential approach. Okay, so just to, while this is up here on the board, I just want to introduce this concept called resolution. We'll call the resolution of an experiment the degree with which the confounding between main effects and other factors occur. So with this system, we had a 2 to the 7th minus 4 setup. And we had our defining relationship up here, which, well, not neatly defined, it's spread out over two boards. But our defining relationship is spread out over here. And the shortest word has got three characters. That's these three over here. All the other words have more characters, three or more. So there's these with three characters, this one is three, four characters. The shortest word we can find is one with three characters. So we'll call that the resolution of the design. And we will append that as a subscript in Roman numerals here. So this is a 2 to the 7 minus 4 factorial of resolution 3 is the nomenclature we use. What do I mean by resolution? Well, an experiment with a higher resolution, say a level 4 resolution, then the shortest word length is 4 characters. So let me just take an arbitrary four characters, A, B, C, D. So say the shortest word is A, B, C, D. Any main effect multiplied by that word is always going to have at most three characters left over. So if I multiply this by A, I'm left with B, C, D, which indicates to you that the main effect A is confounded with B, C, D. Main effect B will be confounded with ACD. Main effect D confounded with ABC. So a resolution 4 design has main effects only confounded with three factor interactions. A resolution 3 design, like this one, has main effects confounded with two factor interactions. So resolution is an indicator of the degree of confounding in the design. So the rule in general is, when you're starting off, pick a design with the lowest resolution and as many factors as possible. And then later on, you can go to higher and higher resolution designs to try and understand, or eliminate rather, the two-factor interactions being confounded with the main effects. Another way you can interpret the resolution is as follows. So this is in page 29 of the notes. Say that main effects equals 1 and a two-factor interaction equals equals 2 and a 3-factor interaction equals a 3, and so on. So then if you say the resolution minus this number, so say a resolution 5 design, so you say 5 minus 1 is 4, so that indicates main effects are confounded with 4-factor interactions. Okay, 5 minus 2 is equal to 3, so that's 2-factor interactions are confounded with 3-factor interactions, or you just get the opposite of these. Okay. So that's how we use the resolution. It's just to determine ahead of time what the degree of confounding is. And then I just make some notes on page 29 that resolution 3 designs, like this design here in 7 factors, 8 experiments, is great for screening. We've discussed that already. And what happens with that is, because it's a resolution 3 design, main effects are confounded with 2-factor interactions. Or conversely, by using this sort of rule, 3 minus 1 would give you 2, so main effects are confounded with 2-factor interactions. And 3 minus 2 is equal to 1, which is giving you the same thing back again. Resolution 4 design is where you start moving on to, if you want to, start getting a handle on more complex phenomena in the system. So we'll call that characterization, or learning about the system. So it's got resolution 4 design has 2-factor interactions confounded with each other, and main effects confounded only with 3-factor interactions, which are typically small, or 3 to 0. And then a resolution 5 design is one of the best you can do, but it's for when you need high accuracy. Okay. So I'll move back to the projector now and just show you the table that's in Box Hunter and Hunter. If you come back to that earlier question, how can you decide where you begin with the system and what are the tables? Okay, so for those of you that have Box Hunter and Hunter in the new edition of page 272, they have this table. I'm just showing like the top left corner is the table that you need there. So the way to read it is on the vertical axis here, they show the number of experiments you have available to yourself. So 4, 8, 16, 32. Along the top row, they show the number of factors that you've got that you plan to experiment with. And this is now where you can trade off. Say you've only got 8 experiments, and you have to run a set of experiments in the second row here. Either you can accommodate 4 factors and run it as a half fraction in 4 factors, and then they show you what you set your generator to. You set your generator at factor 4 is equal to 1, 2, 3. But I tended to use letters, so I would write D equals ABC. If you want to screen for 5 factors, then you know from this table that it's going to be a resolution 3 design, that main effects are confounded with 2-factor interactions. In fact, that is exactly how you generate the design, by setting the main effect of 4 and 5 equal to the 2-factor interactions. Or you could look at screening 6 factors, and then you've got some, you can set that equal to those 2-factor interactions. It's still a resolution 3 design, and then the last one is also a resolution 3 design. So this table goes on, I think, all the way to 12 variables, and it goes down to 128 experiments, which you probably don't need. So that's why I just focused on the top corner. But that's the way to read it, is to trade off your resolution that you're going to use versus your number of runs versus your number of variables. So something like in the course project, where you would be deciding that you would maybe choose that. So let me just talk on that for a minute. I'll just do it by an example drawing plots. I've had a few people ask me questions like, can they use this data set that they've got from the previous course or someone else's data from the lab experiment and so on. And really, the answer is no. The purpose of this little project is for you to think about these trade-offs that we've just discussed. So in this example, I'm looking at growing plants, and what factors could affect the growth height of the plant? Amount of sun, amount of water, soil type, fertilizer added or not, temperature of the room. So there's five factors there already, and so 2 to the 5, 32 two plants if you grow. Maybe you'd want to run some replicas to get averaging. The factors can quickly get pretty big. So yeah, there's some ones that I said, the number of hours of light that you expose the plant to, whether you water it in the morning or afternoon, and so on. There's also disturbances, like some of these could actually be disturbances, and you could block on, say, the position of the plant. If you put it, if you put the container, I'm laughing because I always run into this issue here in Canada. We call it in South Africa, we call these things pot plants. When you grow a plant in a pot. You can't talk about pot plants. Anyway, so you put the pot in a position where there's more or less light or not. And then how many replicates do you have? How many do you do in averaging and so on? Do you plant multiple seeds in the pot? Or is there quadratic effects due to fertilizer and the light effect? Both fertilizer and exposure to light, you're expecting that two-factor interaction. So this is the type of thinking I'm hoping for you to consider when you're looking at your system. What are your variables, particularly this issue of disturbances? I've had a number of interesting discussions with people about some students in the class have already run the experiments. Some of you are just planning them still, but this is where the biggest issue is. So I would say about this, just this setup is about half the marks in the project. Getting the data and then analyzing it and showing how your conclusions match with your original objectives is a very small portion of the project. So when it comes to just reusing another person's data set, then really, no, you're not able to go through this line of thinking that the other person had to go through when they did the work to do the experiments. So this are the sort of things I'd like to focus on. So just there to summarize, particularly this one here. How did you decide on a reasonable design? Did you run a half fraction because of time, because of budget? You could even look at maybe trading off, like I showed on that table with Bob Sainz and Hunter, running more factors with the same number of experiments. How did you go about deciding that design? Okay? So, we've gone through all of this on the board, so there's no need to go through this now. I'll just go through saturated designs and then we'll take a bit of a break. So we're back on page 30 now of your notes, and I think I made a comment there on the top of the second paragraph in section 9.7. I said a saturated design is a resolution 3 design with n minus 1 factors using n experimental runs or n equals 2. So if you just scratch that all out, the saturated design is a design of resolution 3. That's all there is. I was mistaken. Can I put that in? So it's on page 30. And as I've discussed earlier now, the purpose of these very saturated designs is for screening many variables, so lab scale growth, new development, or transfer from a lab to a plant, or a plant to a plant. And I'm just going to look at the analysis of the saturated design. We did that 2 to the 7 factor design on the board. Now we have 7 factors, A, B, C, D, E, G. And we associated AB with B, AC with E, and so on. Now, you run these 8 experiments at these plus and minus levels, and you get these Y data. What does the rest of the analysis look like after this point? It's no different to any of the other experiments you've run so far. You associate those Y data into a vector Y, and X is a matrix of size where you've got 8 rows and the number of columns in X corresponds to exactly what's in this table. There's a column full of intercept, which I don't show, And then you just put your second column in the X matrix would be minus 1 plus 1, minus 1 plus 1. Your third column in X would be the column B. So you literally copy and paste this design matrix as plus and minus 1s and a column of plus 1s, and that's your X matrix. You solve for B in the standard way. And then you get your vector, which is now not just the main effects. In this system, A, as we showed earlier, is associated with all those higher order confounding. But we typically just write A, knowing that it is associated with that confounding. So when we look at the Pareto plot here on the next slide, for that data set, we would see that C in C, A, and G are the most significant effects here. But we know that these are not just the pure effects of C, A, and G. Here for example, E I've written is associated with AC and BG and DF. And in the same way, all the other main effects are associated with at least three other two-factor interactions. But how do you read this plot? The main thing is that I would say variables B, D, and F, or factors B, D, and F are not important here. After this point, really this is a screening design, I would drop factors B, D, and F out of consideration. Okay? The magnitude of those coefficients is much smaller. E is a little bit uncertain because E is confounded with the AC two-factor interaction. And E is, there's a big jump between this and that. But being a screening design, I'm not entirely comfortable just yet dropping out factor E. It could be that the AC interaction is important, or it could be that factor E is really important. It's hard to tell. So my next experiment would focus on AC and G and their interactions. And I would probably keep factor E in there as well. Just a note here then that saturated designs, the 2 to the k minus p runs, we typically have 4, 8, 16, 32 runs here. Now, the problem comes when k gets up to 5, 6, 7, and p doesn't get much smaller, then there's a big jump here between 16 and 32 experiments. What if you'd like to run 20 or 24 experiments? Then you can use these bracket burden designs, which I won't go into. But then any multiple of 4 works very well, particularly for these lower numbers, 20, 24, 28 runs. It's where you can use that. So there's also this paper I've referenced here. What can you find out from just 12 experimental runs? They show that you can screen at least 11 factors from 12 experiments. So it's kind of the same idea that we looked at earlier, screening 8 experiments, screening 7 factors. So if you needed to go up to multiples of 4, but you don't want to go all the way up to 16 and 32 runs, then use these intermediate designs of bracket and burden. Okay, and then coming back to the question there earlier, say you found that factor C, for example, was important. So let's go back up here. Factor C was our main effect, the largest of the main effects. It's confounded heavily. I don't know if I have it here in the slides. I think it's in the notes. At least. Factor C is confounded with A, B, F, and D, G as the two-factor interactions. If you want to figure out after this set of experiments, how do you unconfound factor C with those two-factor interactions? The easiest way to do it is to run another fractional factorial, but instead of setting your factor C, you just flip the signs. Just change the pluses to minuses in C. And you have to go do that to any of the generators that depend on C as well. So, for example, there's a generator over here, I equals ACE. Okay, so we had a generator, one of the generators in this experiment was I equals ACE. we'd also have to go flip that sign. So in other words, that would be C equals A. To take the C back out, we generated, we generated E. Okay, earlier on. Now if I'm flipping signs, every C gets changed to minus C, so I would generate E from A minus AC. So my column P would also flip signs whenever C is changed from A sign. So the idea is you go back to your original fractional factorial that you ran, and just by changing all the signs of the factor of interest, so in this case I'm using C as an example, then you repeat those same set of fractional experiments with those signs flipped. You put the two fractions together into your least squares model, and you will get that C is totally unconfounded. When you estimate factor C, it will be independent of any interaction. There will be no interactions confounded with C. So you will then estimate the pure effect of C. Also, any two-factor interaction that involves C, so for example, it's an AC two-factor interaction, will also be totally unconfounded from anything else. Okay, remember now, this was, you did eight experiments originally, okay? Then you do another eight with those signs flipped, so now you have 16 experiments, that means you have 16 parameters. Okay? So that's why we can estimate C purely on its own, as well as all the two-factor interactions that involve C, so in other words, AC, BC, BC, all the way up to GC, and then estimate the other main effects as well, A, B, D, E, F, and G. So that's where those 16 parameters get allocated to. So you can choose any variable of interest, right? It doesn't have to be factor C. It could be some other variable that seemed interesting and you want to investigate further. So by switching the sign of the factor, you will de-alias, so remove the confounding, in other words, of that main effect. Another way that you can then go and extend your experiment, so once you've done your fraction factorial, you might find that you want to deconfound all main effects. So then what you do is you run the table and flip all the signs of all the letters. So A is minus A, B is minus B. We work through all the generators and flip their signs appropriately. That will increase the resolution of the experiment. You go from a resolution 3 to a resolution 4. You almost run the complementary set of experiments to the original one. And all two factor interactions will be removed from the main effects. So now you can estimate all the main effects without any confounding. So this is perfect actually for when you use this at work. You would say identify seven factors that you're interested in. Run eight experiments, and you get this tremendous confounding. But at least you found the main effects. You can do a preliminary analysis and feedback to your colleagues or your manager. Look, this is what I found. These are the main effects that are important, but realizing that I'm confounded with all these two-factor interactions. You can then get approval to run another eight set of experiments. You go flip all the signs in the table, run another eight experiments, combine those 16 together, and that set of data will have all the two-factor interactions removed from the main effects. So it's a perfect complementary sets to go and extend your experiments with a new set of runs. Rather than arbitrarily just go adding and adding more experiments, this is a systematic way of going about it. So there's two ways of doing it. One is to, we call these folder over design. There's one way where you remove two-factor interaction confounding by flipping all the signs, or you might do something called de-aliasing of just a single main effect, and then you go flip all the signs just of one factor, if that factor is really interesting. Okay, and I'll just wrap up with this section on projectivity, and then we'll take a break. This is one thing that I find really neat, actually, about design experiments, especially for the highly fractionated experiments. A very highly fractionated experiment will always have embedded inside it a full factorial. Okay? here I've shown an example where there's three factors, A, B, and C. And we've only run half the experiments at the closed points. So we've run at these at the solid points, these four experiments. And when you do your preliminary analysis, you discover that main effect C is actually not interesting. There's no main effect C is totally insignificant. So as we showed earlier, when you plot that up on the Pareto plot, you can say to yourself, well, I don't need to consider main effect C anymore in the future. But what that comes down to actually is this dimension C, you're saying doesn't affect my response. Why? It has zero effect. The coefficient is small. So it's as if you could collapse that dimension onto the one in the front. Because the low level of C and the high level of C really doesn't matter in terms of Y. So you can project that in front and you have a full factorial back again. So even though you've done only four experiments to identify A, B, and C, if one of them is not of any use, the remaining two experiments actually form a full factorial, as if you did done the whole thing. So that's great. If you don't go do any more extra experiments, this is a nice way to optimally run your experiments so you can still recover as much information back. And we call that the projectivity of the design. This also holds, and it's hard to illustrate for four dimensions, it's impossible for higher dimensions, but any fractionated experiment has an embedded full factorial. And the way you can find the size of the full factorial is using this formula. You take the resolution of the design, in this case it's a resolution 3 design, minus 1 tells you the degree of projectivity, in this case that's equal to 2. So you get a 2 to the 2 full factorial embedded inside the 2 to the 3 fractional factorial. So take the fractional factorial's resolution, subtract 1, and you get then the dimension of the full factorial that's embedded inside the fractional factorial. I think a different example in notes, but let's come back to this 2 to the 7 minus 4. Resolution 3 design that we started off looking at in this class. So the resolution is 3 minus 1 means that inside this set, this 8 runs, right? Inside this 8 runs, there's a full 2 to the 2 factorial. If you discover that 5 of the factors are not of interest to you, of the 7 factors that you screen for, only 2 are interesting, you can find, no matter which two they are, it doesn't matter how you assign A, B, C, D, E, F, and G, no matter which two they are, you will have the full factorial in those two factors if you drop out the other 5. So you can go find that full factorial and then use the 8 runs. And in fact, with being 8 runs, I'm saying that there's a full 2 to the 2 factorial. What does that mean? In fact, you have replicates on each corner. You've done 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 runs. So you've actually got a replicated 2 to the 2 factorial embedded inside this very highly fractionated factorial, should you discover that 5 of the factors are not of interest to you. Okay? So this is a really great way to go about your work, because there's so many optimal properties related to these experiments being set up in this fractional manner. They're orthogonal, so you can estimate the main effects pretty much by hand. Once X transpose X is, as long as you run it at the correct locations, X transpose X is invertible by hand. X transpose Y is about the hardest thing you have to calculate to then get a go ahead and get a first pass. This is why this stuff has been used for so many years. Okay, so let's take a break for about 10 minutes or so, and we'll come back. What we're going to do is we're going to start at a certain point, and we're going to sequentially move through our system. But remember in the first class we spoke about this sequential approach, we called it class. It's changing one single variable at a time. And we said that was when you started at some baseline and you moved down to point 4, and you realize you come to 1 and you do some more experiments and you come down and reach a plateau and back. We made the IM design the fact that this is really a suboptimal procedure. because you will never land up at the ultimate unless you're extremely lucky. You'll almost always land up at some suboptimal point. So why am I saying now that when we're looking at the response surface methods, we're going to use a sequential approach, and even in the earlier part of the class, we said we do our experiment sequentially. Why are we saying that? Well, it's because when you're doing cost, you're changing a single variable. What we're going to do differently is we're going to change all our variables in one go, but we're still going to do it in a sequential manner. So we're going to move along this response surface. What I'll start off with, though, is by just looking at a single variable, because the concept holds. The concept is identical for a single variable. And you've seen this before if you've taken the optimization course at Vermont. You'll see this as called a line search. So what we do is we're starting off here at this point, 5, 0. And we have a single variable, x1, plotted on the x-axis, that's affecting our y. And the black curve, the curvy line, is the true response of the system, which is unknown. We don't know that black curve. We can only sample it when we do an experiment. So we start our system here at the center point. This is our base condition. And we do an experiment above and below the center point. So we decide we're going to go down by a certain number of units on the x1 axis, and we're going to go up. So we do two experiments. This is a factorial experiment in one variable, or one factor. So we'll measure y, 0 at the minus level, and y0 at the plus level. So the best estimate of what the response surface looks like based on those two data points, y0 minus, y0 plus, is a straight line. It's the tangent line to the true response curve. If we measure closely enough, it will be the tangential line to the true response surface. And because the slope in this particular example is sloping upwards, the direction in which we decide to move next to target the optimum is towards the right. So we take a step of gamma 1 units, and gamma 1 is a user-chosen value. It's a value you're comfortable with implementing on your process. So you move gamma 1 units up, and you land at this new position at the I equals 1 direction. Now, we don't do an experiment here again. We don't measure a value below and above. We just measure the value at the point we land at. And we measure y1. So that's the third data point we take. And it's increasing. So our previous y, we're trying to achieve the optimum for this process, maximize. So we've measured this value, and then this is our third value. That third value is higher than any of the other two that we've had before. So we keep we're making improvements in our process here. This y could be, say, profit, or it could be some yield value. So that's great, because we're improving yield. We'll take another leap of gamma 2 steps, and we measure y2, so it's increasing still further. Okay, remember, we don't know what the black surface is. That black line, our best approximation is that blue line. So we get y2, and we decide, well, we're going to take another step ahead. So gamma 3, and the same step size, gamma 3 units, and we measure y3. So this time y3 is approximately the same value as y2, maybe slightly smaller. But again, we don't know the level of noise in the system. I'm showing an ideal case without error. So we measure exactly the value of the curve, y3. So we figure, based on the data from y0 minus and y0 plus, y1, y2, and y3, if we plot that, we see we've reached a kind of plateau. So we figure, well, somewhere between y2 and y3 is where the optimum was, because we probably bounced over it. Or one other option that's not shown here is that actually the surface just flattens out. I mean, we only know those sample data points. Perhaps the surface is just, we've kind of come up along the edge here, and we don't know really how far along the plateau is. So you've got two options when you get to Y3. You could either keep going, and so here's y2, y3. You can either keep going another step to the right and measure y4 and see, okay, yeah, this is a flat surface, you kind of, as good as you can do there, or you can hop backwards from y3 back because there's what we call straddle the optimum. So y2 is here, y3 is here. You can go back some amount, gamma 4, and figure out where the optimum is and so on. So you've got two choices when you get to y3. In this particular illustration, I've taken y3, I've estimated a new slope. I've actually taken a measurement below and above. I've estimated a new slope. I'm seeing, okay, I need to go back because I've gone too far. And I would then take gamma 4 as my step size and I'd land up here. And I'd probably be pretty close to the optimum. And I could repeat that once or twice just to make sure. So this iterative line search is probably what you've seen in the optimization course before. We're going to do the same thing now, except in more than one variable. But it's the same procedure. You start at some baseline, fit a model that best fits the unknown response surface here in black. So fit a model, that's the blue line. Move along the direction that improves the model until it flattens out. And then you refit the model, so that's the other slope, and then keep going. So it's an iterative procedure, a sequential procedure. Okay. So this system is on page 34 and 35 of your notes. And I'm going to just do this on the board. Page 35, you can just have the figure on page 35 open next to the board and take notes on page 34. That you see there, those are unknown, of course. And this particular system I've chosen is the batch reactor system. Those contours represent buffers. In this case, the reason why I've gone for buffers, and I'll come back to this in a minute, is because usually there's more than one Y of interest. It's not just the yield from the batch reactor that's important. It's also, we can get higher yields, but it's going to cost us more in energy input to get those higher yields. So you can formulate a composite objective function or a weighted objective function that weights all the factors that go into the system and call it profit. And then plot, and there will be a hypothetical contours of profit shown there on page 35. So we don't know that. All we know is that we're operating at some baseline condition. And what we do is, like we did with the single variable case, is we fit a model around our baseline operating point. So our baseline operating point is temperature is 325. So we've got two variables, 325 Kelvin. So we're operating at 325 Kelvin, and the substrate is 0.75 grams per liter. And the profit at that operating point, we just call this Y on it. So this is our baseline profit, is 400 and some dollars. So we fit a model around this point, and we'll fit a factorial model, where the low level of temperature, so T minus, T plus, and we'll have S minus and S plus. And based on the knowledge of the system, you'll see a lot of this in response to this method. It's based on your knowledge of the system. You decide. There's no right or wrong answer in these cases. It's all your knowledge. So in terms of temperature, I've decided to move this range of temperature at 10 Kelvin. So our center point is 325. T minus corresponds to 320. And T plus corresponds to 330 Kelvin. So we'll use this notation that delta T is being denote for delta T like that is 10 Kelvin. Similarly, delta subscript S or the S factor is 0.5 grams. So the lower level here corresponds to 0.5 and the upper level corresponds to 1 gram per liter. So if we code that up in terms of our usual minus 1 plus 1 notation, we'll have TS and we'll have Y, our profit. So T equals minus plus minus plus. And we measure those four responses written in any of those 193, 310, 468, and $571. Okay, so actually the best way to visualize this is right here on this system, 193, 310. Now, with any of these responsiveness methods, you're aiming to maximize this particular variable. So we draw contours and find which is the direction in which we should go up. So I've superimposed on page 35 some contours, but if you're doing this by hand, usually the best way to go about it is to look at it as follows. So 310 is the y variable in this bottom right corner. So just take a look here. So the easiest way is, see that's 310, somewhere over here is going to be 310, or that's 450, or that's 200. So 310 is going to be somewhere right here. And the first contour can be drawn like that. Then 468 is over here, so say that's 450. That's going to be around 500, so 50 is going to be something over there. So the contours in the system generally look something like that. And we know that as well, if we want to go and improve the y value in the system, we head to this corner here, 0.721. It kind of just matches with what we're thinking as well. So this direction, going in that direction, would be the next step to maximize the profit. So increase temperature, go to higher levels of temperature, higher levels of the S factor. Substrate concentration, it seems to be the best direction to go in. So that's just by hand, just visualizing the system, but let's do it a bit more systematically. So we fit a linear model at that point, and I'm not going to go through the mechanics of fitting the main effects and two-factor interaction. I'll just write here that you can get y hat is equal to 386 plus 55 xt plus 134 xs minus about 4. So the interaction term is much, much smaller. Much smaller effect from the interaction term than the main effect of 55 and 134. And we saw that as well. The contours here look to be roughly linear. I drew them linear, but you can verify that on the computer. And the contours I've shown on page 35, which on the figure on the left there, I've superimposed on top of the trip contours, the straight line contours represent the contours from this model. So I've just drawn in that local region with contours from the factorial system. Okay. So just to this question has come up before. I'll just go over what is xt. Xt is our coded variable. It represents x temperature actual minus the center point for t, which in this case is 325 Kelvin. That's our center point over here. Our baseline conditions around which we've created this factorial, divided by the range of t. Can we take half of that? Okay. So xt minus 1 corresponds to this value over here, 320 Kelvin. That's the value at which we run that experiment, 320 Kelvin. when x t is plus, that's 330. Similarly for the substrate variable, xs, so you can write the same thing out. In this case, Cp for the s is equal to 0.35 grams per liter, and the range of the substrate variable is equal to 0.5. And just the reason why I'm going over it is we're going to need it in a minute. Now, when we start moving along this direction, we want to move. It's easy enough to see on this system how it moves, but this is not in real world units. This is encoded variables of minus 1 and plus 1, minus 1 and plus 1. We need to undo that coding to tell our operators, or graduate students who slaved in doing this work, take the system to xt actual or xs actual. Okay. So we need to use this equation here to undo that. Quantify this direction. Well, this is the direction of maximum asset. So you'll recall from a math course, I presume, or optimization course, the direction of maximum or steepest ascent is perpendicular to the contour line. Okay? So what's the equation of the contour line? The contour line could be written as, well, we can take y hat, so remember there's about 385, plus 35 xt plus 134 xs. I'm going to drop off the two-factor interaction, it's really small. So if I rearrange this equation tells me, if I give it xt and xs, it tells me my predicted value of y. Okay? I can just rearrange this equation to be more suitable. I can write minus 134 xs is equal to 385 minus y hat plus 55 xt. Okay, you can see where this is going. If xs is equal to 385 minus y hat divided by minus 134 plus or rather minus. Okay, so now this equation is in the form if I give it y hat and I give it xt, I get xs out. So it says, say I want to see this contour line of 310. I know y hat is 310. What is the contour line of 310? I say 385 minus 310 divided by minus 134. That tells me my intercept. Minus that slope, 55 over 134 xt. And I'll get, so this relates xs, which is on the y-axis, to xt, which is on the x-axis. So that's the equation of the contour lines. And from high school, then you would know the normal direction. Or it's a better way to say that the slope, rather, the normal slope is equal to the inverse, negative inverse of that, so it would be 134 over 55. So the slope of steepest ascent is 134 over 55 in that direction. I mean, that gels with what we have here visually, right? So this first equation here shows a negative slope from the contour lines that follows these lines here. They're sloped down and negatively sloped. The direction of steepest ascent is a positive slope. I'm just pointing this out so that you understand better the mechanics of what we're plotting here on this graph. Okay. Okay, so what we're still after we've kind of just looked at the contour lines and we've looked at the direction in which we need to go. We still haven't said how far do we need to go. So another way to see the direction of how much we need to go, is by just taking the partial derivative of this equation for y. You take the y hat, dx t is equal to 55, and dy hat, dx t. I'll ignore the two-factor interaction, it's so tiny that 4xt is too small, so you haven't considered it. So what this says is, when we move in that direction, move up 55 units in xt, so we'll move 55 units in xt, and we'll move 134 units. Okay. Now, this is encoded units. So let's get back to real world units. So over there, let me just bring this board back down. So if that's xt, this is encoded units, delta xt is just equal to delta xt actual divided by the range of t. So the center point drops off if you take the deltas. And suddenly for the substitute bracket. So range of t was equal to 10 Kelvin, and range of S, 0.5 centimeters. Okay. So this is the scaling factor by which we used on the axis over here, to code minus 1 and plus 1. We have to use that to undo this step. So what we say is, we're going to move 55 units along in delta XT, encoded units. So in real world units, that corresponds to, let me just say, the real world units. That would be 55 times delta XT over 2. So we're moving 55 units. Let me just make this clear that this equals to delta. We're going to move 55 units of delta xt, 134 units, that is equal to delta xt. So in real world units, in terms of the temperature variable, that's 55 times 10 divided by 2 Kelvin, 55 by 2 is 270. 275 Kelvin. And in terms of the substrate variable, that would be 34 units in the substrate variable, and its scaling factor is 0.5 grams per meter by 2, so we need to tell our operators to take that up to 33.5. Okay. so these two, that would be the step size for the temperature to go up 275 units. That would correspond to the full step of dy by dx is 55. The full step would correspond to the huge increase of 275. We would never go from 325 Kelvin all the way up to 600 Kelvin. And it takes the grams per liter from 0.75 up to 23 times. That full step is just too big. Okay, and that's common with when you're doing these response surface methods, the full step size is way bigger than you would actually implement. So we just take a proportional step. Okay? So we take a proportional step, and I'll call the proportionality factor, which is called gamma. Okay, so instead of taking 275 or 33.5, usually what one does is you pick one of them. I'm going to move 5 Kelvin, or I'm going to move 1 gram per liter, and then you ratio the other one accordingly. I'm just going to take delta T actual as 5 Kelvin. So you set that equal 5 Kelvin. So our proportionality factor gamma is going to be 5 divided by 275. So when we move delta, where we need to move the S variable, we'll just move it by that same proportionality factor. So this is, on the bottom of page 34, I use this notation. I'll talk about why, because I've got, we'll call this point 1, 2, 3, and 4. So our next point, which we operate is point 5, we'll call that S5 is equal to S zero, or S baseline, the center point, which was 0.75, plus a full step in S is 33.5 grams per liter times gamma. So we'll take some fraction of that full step size. And T5 is equal to our baseline temperature plus 275 Kelvin times some proportionality factor. You compute this gamma by deciding which is a comfortable step size to take. In this case, I've decided I don't want to move away from my center point by more than 5 Kelvin. I want to just explore pretty slowly. You can accelerate gamma later on in the next iteration, but let's just be kind of cautious. This is maybe a new system. We're not sure how far we can push it. There may be safety concerns as well. So, just plugging in the numbers here, that would be our center point was 4.75 plus 33.5 times 5 over 275. So our next operating point is 1.36 grams per liter. And in terms of temperature, that's 325. Well, that obviously has to be 5 Kelvin, that just cancels out. Okay, so all that work and we get what our next operating point is going to be. In terms of a picture, we were operating our original factorial, 1, 2, 3, 4. The fifth point happens to be right on the same level over here. It's going to be somewhere over here. So we're moving from our center point of the factorial in a direction, and we're moving, that's 0.5. And you run your experiment there, and you get Y5 is equal to, in this case, $669. So we've gone from points with 193, 310, 468, $571 in profit. Operating point makes us much more money, $670 per kilogram of product. So we're pretty happy with this improvement.
I just have a question about the 5 degree increase, because We already have two measurements at that temperature, so yeah. Wouldn't it be better to increase that a little more?
You could, and then substrate would also just go up as well, as long as it's proportional. Yeah. But my main concern was that the vector is 130, just take a look back here, dy by dxs is 134. So a small move in xt is a bigger move in xs. So I'd be safer to go with 5 Kelvin still. Yeah. You could. I mean, I'm just picking up numbers here for the system to illustrate this. That you would know better on a real system how far you want to go. Okay, so we're happy with that improvement. So we can say, well, let's take another step of 5 Kelvin. So we're moving from 0.6 up to 0.7, sorry, 0.5 to 0.6. So this time T6 is equal to T5 plus 5 Kelvin, plus, T75 gamma. T275 is because so this was if we had taken a full step in T and a full step in S corresponds to that. So we're going to take the proportional step in T plus 33.5. And gamma is the same number as we had before. You can plug that in and get your next operating point is 335 Kelvin, and in terms of substrate it's 1.97. Run that experiment, maybe it takes another day or two before you get the results back, or it could even be longer, but you would get information Y6, your profit has increased to 688. Okay. So it's increased a little bit, not a whole lot at all. So we've gone from $670 to $688. It's not a very big increase compared to the first step we made. Okay. We can then just continue that on again and then take another step. I won't go through the details here, but you would get another. We get that T7 is 340 Kelvin and that T. S7 is 2.58. You would then get that now your profit actually does drop quite significantly. It's actually 460. So if you take a look at the figure on page 35 in the notes, the figure on the left hand side shows the factorial plus those step 5, 6, and 7. And you can see then how it overshot the optimum. So, given that we've gone so far, my inclination would be to go back to step 6 and figure out what's gone wrong. Right? Remember when I showed you the univariate case, when we looked at the univariate case, we went up our slope for a few points, and then we went over here when it started to decrease. What we said then was we'll fit a new local model to that point. Maybe the system changes, right? This is a biological system. The pathway mechanisms are totally different when you move to the higher substrate and higher temperature. Chemical processes tend to kind of have these operating regions. We probably entered a different mode of process operation, a different side effect, different side products are being used, a different reaction mechanism is in place. So when you get to this system where your model doesn't work for you anymore, you stop, backtrack to the last best situation, and you decide to refit your model at that point. So that's what we'll do. We'll backtrack to 0.6, and we're going to fit a new model around that region. So we'll fit four experiments, now two factors. Okay, and these would be experiments 8, 9, 10, and 11. we'll just visualize it here. We've got temperature, 9 plus this is this plus. We get experiment 9, I'm sorry, 8, and it gets a profit of 694. I'll talk a bit about how I've got these values in this. And we actually have a center point. We put our center point of our factorial at this last best point. So the center point actually of our new factorial is 335. The coordinates over here of that point corresponds to 335 Kelvin. And 1.97 Kelvin per meter. The magnitude by which I move left and right about the center point, I can change. I don't have to use the same delta T and delta S that I had up here. Initially, I used 10 Kelvin and 0.5 grams per liter. I might be inclined to use slightly different values when I lay down my new factorial. It's entirely up to your discretion. There's no right and wrong set up here. In this particular instance, I've chosen delta, if you just consistent with this notation, delta T is equal to 10 Kelvin, so 8. And the substrate is 0.4. And as I made mention in the notes, that corresponds to 339 Kelvin on the high end. So 4 degrees up from that, down to 331 on the lower end. And in terms of substrate, that is 2.17 grams. I just take my center points, I decide what my deltas are going to be on either side, and I just find those 4 operating points, 8, 9, 10, and 11. And do my 4 experiments at those points. You can estimate the linear model this time. This one, 7. Okay. So, what's of interest here to me this time is how different the model is. In terms of the size of the coefficients, I'm only getting magnitude 13. In terms of temperature, 39 for the substrate. What really surprised me was that I got a very small interaction. So I was expecting to kind of, well, why is this model not working? It could be because I'm on a ridge, on a curved area, so then interactions are not important. But it wasn't the interactions. I'll show you in a minute what it is that's different about the system, why. But there's, just taking a look at this plot again, like we did earlier, we plotted the gradient and we plotted the directions. For which way would you see the contours moving? Just take a look at the 4 data points there. In which direction would you move next? So that's, we see that as well from the coefficients here, yeah, from the main effects. It says root 13. The direction of steepest ascent is 13 units in the temperature direction and negative 39 in the substrate direction. Okay. So you can do that and go through the whole process again where we decide a full step of 13 units, we can calculate what that is in real world units. We can say a step of minus 39 in real world units, calculate what that is. But that's exactly like we did there earlier. So I'm not going to what you'll find though, if you do that, a real world step, so the real world delta XT would correspond to 52 Kelvin. So again, just a big jump that you've never implemented in practice. And delta XS. I'm just going to call you consistent here. So over the delta x t actual. In real world units would be minus 7.5. So again, I say now these are too big to take. I'm going to take it. I'm going to be taking a step size of 4 Kelvin rather than a step size of 52. So in this case, I set gamma equals 4 over 52. And I take a step. I take a step in the direction where you mentioned it earlier. I go down somewhere over here, okay, in that direction. That would be the direction of steepest ascent. But I find, actually, when I take that step, I'll get 0.12. So we're at 8, 9, 10, and 11. This is our 12th experiment we're running. You can calculate the temperature and the substrate values for that 12th point, but why 12 is... $716. Okay. So I'm not so excited by this because this point over here was $725. And this kind of seems to say, well, why are you taking the step? Like, it's such a small difference and it's actually a decrease. Like, this was supposed to be our direction of maximum ascent. Why is it actually makes a lower profit value? So there's some issue going along with the point where we happen to be at. This particular point is something that we're not taking into account. Any guesses? It's not a two-factor interaction. It's not the temperature-substrate interaction because the coefficient for that term is this, 2.4. So it really is pretty small compared to the 13 and 39. Any guesses what's going on? Why is this? Like, we're so used to factorials kind of pointing us in that direction. Why is this one giving us this misleading result of saying, go down, we get to point number 12, and we get a profit, but we're not giving any better.
I'd say because the optimum is a single point, so if we take a certain size of snap,
you're right. There are cases where, yeah, you, this step is too far. So yeah, you could bring this in a little bit and maybe we went, maybe the optimum was somewhere in this region and we kind of overshot it again. That's one option. Yeah, or like you say, you can go somewhere and then you get zigzagged around. And that usually happens when, so you had contact like this, you kind of hunt around this area. Yeah, that's what one thing that happened. The thing that's happening here is that there's a quadratic effect. We've got a linear model in XT, XS, and XT and XS. But what about the quadratic effect of temperature and substrate? So a second order effect. We haven't really been taking any second order effects into account. So it really could be in that curvature due to the quadratic effect that's showing up here. And one way you can estimate this, one way you can quickly find out whether that's present or not, without actually having to do all the experiments to fit a second order model, is to just compare the center points with the intercept. Why is that? So let's take a look. The center point, what is the value for XT in the coded units? From XT and XS at the center point? Zero, right? So a few people saying zero. XT is zero at the center, and XS is zero. So here's minus one, zero, plus one. Minus one, zero, plus one. So that center point has got values of XT and XS is zero. Plug zero into this equation, and we get this intercept term. That's why this intercept term, I don't know if any of you have kind of been asking yourselves, why are we always keeping this intercept term around? In the Pareto plot, I'm saying don't show the intercept term, but you always keep it in the model. Why is this intercept so important to us? It is because it's an estimate of the response at the center. So if this has a slope uniformly going up and up and up, this should be an estimate of the value you get at the center of the factorial. Okay? So 670 is an estimate of y center point. So y hat at center point is 670. But we also know what the center point is from an experiment. Experiment 6 has been erased, y6. y6 is actually the center point. So notice the notation of y hat center point is 670. The actual center point, y6, was 688. Okay? So it doesn't seem like a big difference, $18. But when you compare it to the main effect of a 1 unit change in temperature increases your profit by 13 units. And the 1 unit change in substrate decreases you by $39. So this difference between what you expect and what you actually get is worth more than one complete step in temperature. It's larger than this 13 coefficient over here for temperature. So there's definitely one way you can visualize this is we're fitting a model fitting a linear model to the system, but it's actually doing that in the center. And this measure, so this is our minus one level, this is our plus one level, this is our estimate y center point at, and that is y center point actual. So this difference between y center point and y center point at is that degree of curvature. So we'll call that an estimate of curvature. So the discrepancy over there would be an estimate of curvature for the system. So when that gets large, you should be aware that you need to start adding quadratic terms to your model. Okay? So let's take a look how we can do that. To add a quadratic effect, you could say, well, I would like a model where y is my intercept plus btxt, so estimate the temperature effect, plus an estimate of the substrate effect, plus an estimate of the interaction term, plus, and we'll use this notation btt for bsxs. So we'll add these two additional terms to the model. So we now have six parameters. So we need more than just the five data points that we have. So we've got a center point, and we've got four corner points. So we've got five knowns and six unknowns. So we need to add some more data points to the system, take some more measurements in order to estimate those quadratic terms. So one thing you can do is you could just say, well, I'm going to measure face points. You can add a point here on each face. Okay, that would be one valid way of getting an additional four data points into the system. So now you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 data points and 6 unknowns. You've got an overdetermined system, that's great. You've even got 3 degrees of freedom with which to estimate standard error. But there's a more systematic way of doing it, and that's called central composite designs. So these are designs, again, you'll see the name George Box coming up over and over, which Box and some of the co-workers have looked at. And I illustrate them on page 37. These are for a two-factor system. The central composite design is equal to a factorial, so your ordinary factorial, plus a center point, plus some axial points, which actually extend beyond the factors over there. They extend beyond the factors by this degree called alpha, and for a two-factor system, alpha is equal to 1.4. So if you looked at a central composite design, let me change boards here. And the reason why it actually includes a full factorial plus these axial points is so that you can add your central composite design to an existing factorial. So we've got our existing factorial now. We can just go add these additional 5 extra runs, the center point plus those 4 axial points, to get a full central composite design. Okay? So in terms of this diagram, the central composite design would place an experiment here, here, down here, and over here. Okay? With that distance, and this distance, would be alpha steps away from the center point. And alpha for a two-factor system is the square root of 2. Okay. So that's a central composite design. For a three-factor system, alpha is 1.68 or 1.7. And for four-factor systems, you read alpha out of the table because there's different ways of estimating alpha. You can have then you can optimize alpha for rotatability, so you can rotate this design and still measure the same parameters. We won't go into how the CCD or central composite design is derived, other than to just use the case for when there's two factors in the system, use alpha equals that, and for when three factors in the system, that's 1.7. Okay? So I illustrate that in the notes on page 37. So that's what we do now. We've got points 8, 9, 10, and 11. We've got our center point 6, and our points over here, I'll call this, this diagram here, this is the center space here. So we'll call these points 13, 14, 15, and 16. That's because we took Y12 was our step that we took out, and we kind of realized that things weren't going right again. So 13 would be this first point over here, 14, 15, 16. Okay, so we need to, we've got a model with 6 unknowns, and we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 data points. So 9 data and 6 unknowns. Okay, so how do we set up the X and Y matrices for this single fabric? So we would just put this Y8. So this corresponds to our 4 factorial points. We have Y6 for our center point and Y13. So this is, I'm writing y equals x heat. X would be, we'll get to that, and then b is going to be u0. Okay. So this is standard. Whenever you get a system where there's unusual experiments being done, then you use least squares. Ordinarily, you can kind of work it out by hand what the main effects and interactions are, because the system is fully determined. You've got as many unknowns as known as data points. But in a system which is overdetermined, you have more data than unknowns, you have to resort to using least squares. Another case where you have to actually resort to using the squares, and I think I mentioned this in the last class, just as a quick aside, it's not related to this response idea. But say you had a factorial hat minus 1 plus 1, plus 1 minus 1. And this is temperature, say, and concentration. And you plan the factorial to run at these 4 points. And when you're about to implement the 4th point, the operator says, hang on, you can't run at high temperature and high concentration. There's a safety concern for that. But, okay, you can run at reduced concentration or reduced temperature. Okay, in other words, there's a constraint here that you cannot operate in. So you put your run over here. So then you have 5 runs in 4 unknowns. Then you just find out what that corresponding value is. So here's 0, 0. This might have been 0.3 in terms of x1, and it's obviously plus 1 in terms of x2. Or in terms of the concentration variable. In terms of the temperature variable, this point over here is plus 1, but in terms of the concentration variable, that might have been 0.2. So then you would just put that into your X matrix rather than plus 1s and minus 1s. So we're going to do the same thing over here now. The first 4 data points are trivial. Just take a look. 8, 9, 10, and 11 are from our ordinary factorial. We just put minus 1. Well, actually, the first column is the intercept, so that's plus 1. Okay. The second column is corresponds to the temperature effect, so in order of 8, 9, 10, and 11. So 8, 9, 10, and 11 corresponds to minus 1, plus 1. So that's the temperature effect. The effect would be BTS, the product of the two. And then what would be the last two columns? What's the column for BTT look like? Same for okay. The center point. That's always the intercept is plus 1. And the remaining terms are 0. So that's the center point. Now, the next 4 terms, the next 4 data points correspond to observation 13. Let's just take observation 13 first. So in terms of the intercept, it's always plus 1. What is the code that I need to put in here for the temperature? Temperature? Are you sure?
1.4.
Are you sure? Another try. And in terms of temperature, so BT. Take a look. The temperature is on this axis here. Okay. So what is the coefficient for temperature at this point? 0. And now for substrate, for this point. Negative which 1.4. Okay. And then BTS is the product of the two, BTT. And the last column. It's easy. And 14 is point data point 14 is 1, then. In terms of the temperature effect, yep. 0, actually the term BTS is always going to be 0, and then 2, 0, great. The last one, second last one, Y15 up at the top is 1, so it's the same temperature value, this one, plus 1, equal 1, 0, 0, 2, 1, 0, 0, 2, 0.
Yes,
okay. So the column of zeros, because they're all, because these center points are never interacting. And you plug this into R or MATLAB, and you calculate your model. Calculate that, you would get y equals 688 plus 12.9 xt. So the temperature effect is 30 units. Contrast that to the temperature model we got earlier. So this was the earlier model we got for y hat. Only the full factorial. So the temperature effect we had 13. When we use this model with quadratic terms, we're still getting roughly 13 as our temperature effect. Okay. In terms of the substrate effect, -39.1. So that was also accurate, actually, compared to the factorial model. The interaction term, I got a little bit of a mistake in the notes on page 37. I've got a plus and a minus. It's minus 2.4. This is on the bottom of page 37, in stage there. And then in terms of, also just to focus on that, in fact, it's the identical coefficient as what we got over here. So in fact, the linear model really had nothing wrong with it. We got the same estimate of temperature, the same estimate of substrate, the same interaction effect. The only difference that what we were lacking was these quadratic terms. Into temperature, so that's minus 4.2 x squared, and it was minus 12.2 x. So really, a very strong second order effect from the substrate. That was what we were missing. That's why when we took that exploratory step, y12 earlier, we went from the center point out here, y12 was over this, and went. That's why it was so far off, because we didn't have an estimate of the second order effect in the system. Okay, so a pretty long exercise to kind of get to where we want to go. At this point, what did we do? Right? So we still haven't reached the optimum, so what did we do? Well, we do like what we did at every other point. When we built a model for the factorial, we then estimate the step in which to move. But for these second-order models, it's really it's a bit messy to do that. So what we generally do is we plot these up in computer software and look at how the slopes appear and then find visually the next best operating point. Okay, and that's what's shown in your notes on page 35. Has everyone got this down? Can I bring the screen? Okay, so just to recap real quickly what the steps were, this is where we started off. We started off at that baseline. Then we moved up. We did that because we estimated these green contours. You notice these linear lines from the factorial model. They don't quite match the curvature from a true unknown contour. But those are, they're pretty good, right? So here's the true unknown contour of 400. The green contour, the straight line, matches that to a good approximation. So we go perpendicular to that direction, and I just make a note here, it doesn't look like we're going perpendicular because to get this thing fitting on the screen, I've had to pull it out like that, but in your notes, the aspect ratio is correct. But here, I've had to skew it out, so it doesn't look like we're going 90 degrees to that green line. We really are. We landed at 0.5 and 6, and then we went a little bit too far and got 2.7. If we backtrack to 0.6, we fit a new factorial at that point. We jumped out to 0.12. That was when we discovered that there's something a little bit unusual about this factorial. As we later discovered, it's because we need to add some of these axial points, complete the central composite design, those additional 4 points in red. And then when we fit that full nonlinear model at that point, there's the gradient contours in red that correspond to that full model that we developed up there on the board. So those quadratic terms really approximate this a lot better. So notice here, here's the $700 profit contour, this wavy line that goes around. Notice how well the $700 red contour from the quadratic model approximates that. So this is where you decide then where to go. You look at these red contours and you say, I'm going to move my next operating point to the center point over there. That's the best estimate of the optimum you have. Okay, it doesn't quite match the true optimum, which is just a little bit over it. But then once you get to that point, we'll use some tools that I'll show you in the next section to approach the optimum more closely. But this is how you use this tool. The factorials are easy because once you fit the factorial model, you just go into the direction of steepest ascent. But a model with quadratic terms is, what is this, the direction of steepest ascent? So it's a little hard to figure out. You can probably do it on paper, but it's messy. So just plot it up in the computer and figure out, okay, my next operating point is over there. Okay. So this is an alternative to the change one at a time, that cost approach we started off the DOE section with 2 weeks ago. We said don't change your variables one at a time. Change them simultaneously. It's still sequential. We still go through the system here, but we changed all our variables. Okay. So, okay, I won't go through this general approach. I'm just really listing what I just said there. And this is all in the notes. Just a comment here on what happens if you've got two Y variables that you're interested in. This figure is not in your notes. I'm just showing you different. What happens if you have two Y's? So, for example, in this case, solid contours are due to the yield. Solid contours are due to cost. And the dashed contour line is due to yield. You'd like to minimize the cost and maximize yield simultaneously. Those two don't always match up. So this is a great way to show the data. When you do your experiment, each experiment, you measure both the cost and the yield. Then you plot these contour plots and you superimpose them. You can now show your colleagues, or manager, or whoever, what the real trade-offs are. You can see that maximum yield is in this zone, minimum cost is in that zone, just next to it. You operate at some sort of intersection or some trading. This is a pretty clean one. Usually they're far separated, so you have to find where that optimum operating point is. But it's always a trade-off, right? Very seldom do you find that these things line up exactly where you want. So this is where the computer software is really helpful. We won't go too much into this course in how you use that, but there's some good software packages that will show these surface plots for three or four variables, and you can get a figure out where those options lie. Okay, do you want to take a 2-3 minute break? I just got a few more slides to end off this section, or how do you want to go? Take a break?
No.
No? Just going. Okay. So what the concept of evolutionary operation is when we saw here earlier, we didn't quite land up in our optimum zone over here. When we get here to that 735, we'll move to that next point, but the true optimum is a little ways over. And most chemical processes, that optimum isn't stationary. Your heat exchangers will foul, you have catalysts deactivating on you, you have slow-moving disturbances that take weeks or months. Even just the annual temperature cycle is a disturbance as well. That optimum shifts, it's not stationary. So we use the same concept that we used here of radical movement from a baseline. This is, you use response surface methods when you're developing a process, or you've got some free reign, because every time you do one of these, you've got to upset the process. The product you produce here at 0.5, 6, and especially 0.7, you may not even be able to sell that product. So you're really pushing the process around into regions you've never experienced before. You're not sure what's going to happen. But evolutionary operation follows the same concept of moving around, but you make much, much smaller steps. So you make these very tiny perturbations in more than one factor. So 2, 3, 4 variables, you run a fractional factorial or partial or factorial, but very small changes. And you have to do this with approval of your boss and colleagues and so on. This is not just something you go ahead and do. But you make these small perturbations within the daily production schedule. This is still the product that you're going to sell. But what you're finding is, where do I move my process to in small amounts to keep tracking that optimum, to keep following it? And you keep moving along the response. So I'm not going to go into the details here. There's good books on this. Evolutionary operation is something, if you mention it at a workplace, people know about it already. It's been around for over 50, 60 years. So it's not that very often. And that's a sad thing. So there's really a lot of good money to be made. Okay, then just some final comments to wrap up the session. So I've already mentioned this earlier based on a question that you had there earlier, but the best time to run an experiment is after the experiment. And that's really because you don't know enough about which factors are important. How much do you move the variables by? What's a good low value and what's a good high value? And you've got all this uncertainty, which is kind of why I'm getting you to do the project on design experiments. You're maybe asking yourself, well, I want to bake a recipe. How low do I go with the flour or the baking powder? Because another group in the class have had all these questions last week were asking me, how do I know where's the low level and where's the high level? You don't. The best time to run an experiment is after your first experiment. So get going with it and don't spend a lot of the budget up front. So get started, and then you can do all these sequential experiments. So these are the phases typically. You do some screening. Then you do a fold over design. So maybe you go from your 2 to the 7 minus 4 factorial. You have 7 factors, so 2 to the 7 minus 4, the resolution 3 factorial. That's 8 runs. Then you do another 8 runs. Well, this actually becomes a 2 to the 7 minus 5 factorial, and maybe the resolution increases depending on how you choose to do those additional runs. Eventually, you'll move up to a resolution 4, and maybe even a resolution 5. But a resolution 4 design means that you can start estimating main effects separate from interactions. And you use these designs for response surface models. When I did the response surface model to illustrate it here in class, I only used 2 variables. But you can use 3 or 4 variables. Then at each time you do that factorial, you don't do a full factorial. You can do a fractional factorial or a half fractional. And then once you get to the optima, you try to maintain the optimum by using that idea of evolutionary operation. You make small changes. Okay. This I've kind of mentioned already, when you make a mistake. So for example, when you cannot get to minus 1.5 due to some constraint that you didn't anticipate, just use least squares. But the problem is that you lose orthogonality, that X matrix isn't orthogonal anymore. So your estimates are confounded, like they actually interact with each other. You may also have missing values. So one thing you can do, this comes up also with the projects. Say you have a system where you only have you have three factors. So in other words, you need a 2-to-3 system with 8 experiments, but you only have 6 experiments. Okay. So it's an underdetermined system. How would you, you don't want to say, well, I can't do anything with this data. You've got 6 valuable pieces of information that probably cost you some money to get. What can you do with it? Well, in a system that's 2-to-3, there's a cube, right? So depending on which 2 experiments are missing, remember the main effects along this cube are estimated 4 times. You're estimating the main effects of this variable once over here, measuring it over there, over there, and over there. You get 4 estimates of the main effect. Okay? That's if you've got all the data. But if you're missing maybe that corner over there and that corner over there, well, you can still estimate the main effect at least twice. And these effects on the other side of the cube, you can estimate those 2. And then factor C, you can estimate once and twice over there. So you can still estimate the main effects. Or you can just plug this into a least squares model. But you have to take a little bit of care because you've got 6 data points and 8 unknowns. So what you can do is, in your vector V, you can say, well, I need to estimate my intercept, I need to estimate BA, BB, BC, those 3 main effects. And you can say, well, I'm going to sacrifice the BABC, three-factor interaction, and I'll sacrifice the BBC interaction because I know that that's not going to be important. And then you would just put in the other 2 bits of BAB and the AC. So now your B vector is 6 unknowns. You write out the corresponding X matrix and you realize I just won't be able to estimate those 2. So even though you've got some missing values, you can still get quite far along with them. Okay, if you know ahead of time that you're going to have constraints, I'll talk about this idea of using an optimal design. So you realize I have this constraint. You operate at those 2 points, but you lose orthogonality. The X matrix now has non, usually you have 0 off-diagonal elements. Now you'll have some non-zero off-diagonal elements. But this idea of optimal designs is if you have the freedom to move this location and this location around, where would you put them so that you have the most orthogonal matrix possible? That's the principle of optimal designs. Is if you have the freedom to move some of these operating points around, and sometimes the constraints aren't as nice as this, they're probably more complex, especially on a system with 3 axes, then that's not a straight line anymore. Now it's a plane that's kind of, you're cutting off part of your operating space with a plane. The principle of optimal design is where can you put your experiments so that you get the most orthogonal matrix possible. And one way you can estimate orthogonality is the determinant of X transpose X. So the determinant of X transpose X is one way. If you maximize the determinant of X transpose X, you're maximizing the orthogonality. The orthogonal matrix has the highest determinant possible. Anything less has a lower value. So if you can get the highest determinant possible, you would have had this idea that you get the most orthogonality. So that's what optimal designs are about. But I just want to bring this idea up. You'll see a lot of it. People say, well, use a de-optimal design. Use an optimal design of some sort. Like there's A optimal, and D optimal, and G optimal, and B optimal, and I optimal designs. All of them optimize a different criteria. But then you should ask yourself, well, what if we just spent 3 weeks learning about factorials? Why are they suboptimal? Well, they're not. All the stuff we've looked at are A optimal, D optimal, B optimal, and G optimal. All the factorial designs we've looked at meet all the optimality criteria. So don't get kind of pulled into this buzzword that people say, oh, you have to use an optimal design. You don't have to. A factorial design is optimal in all those respects already. You only need to use optimal designs when you have very complex constraints. So for example, a cubic system with three factors, and your constraint is a plane that slices off a corner, a region over here. So it slices off a whole region that's now not available to you. Now where do you place your experiments? You can place them on this. Usually you'll find that these algorithms will place them for you in to maximize the volume of things in span. So you need to use an optimal design when you're using these complex constraints. Maybe you're using a non-standard model, like maybe there's an exponential term in there. Or you want to run, say, only five experiments. So you ask the computer, generate me five experiments that lead to the most orthogonal matrix possible. Or maybe you have two levels per factor. So this is common. Sometimes we'll use three. So along one face of the cube, you may have three experiments here and three experiments over there. So when you bring that in, how do you find that optimality criteria of where to place your experiments? So the way these things work is you specify a model, the computer finds all possible combinations. So you plug in, say I've got three factors and I have this constraint that cuts through this way. Then the computer just generates a grid in the rest of the space. It generates a very fine grid throughout that space, and it says these are all potential candidate points. So any intersection on the grid are potential candidate points. So it may generate a list of 200-300 potential experiments. And you can go say, well, I want an experiment at this particular corner as well. So it just adds that to the list. And then it just says, asks you, okay, well, of these, how many experiments do you want to run? And you say, I've got a budget to run 12 experiments. And then it goes and finds through this list, which is called the candidate set. So these are the candidates. It just screens through the candidate set iteratively and finds the 12 experiments that maximizes that criteria. So you always have to use a computer for the optimal design. And that's just a bit about what these different designs are optimizing. And just to note here that full 2 to the k factorial is already optimal in terms of the A, B, G, and B criteria. And most are often you see D optimal designs. The reason why it's D optimal is because it's maximizing the determinant, the D, so the determinant, which corresponds to the lowest variance on the coefficients. Okay? Because remember that the variance for Bi is equal to x transpose x inverse times the standard error. So by maximizing the determinant, you're minimizing the standard error over all the coefficients. That's why D optimal is so widely used. Okay. And this is just the last slide. It's more just so you're aware of this. Like the concept of D-optimal designs is not in the exam, but I just want you to be aware of the nomenclature so that when people talk to you about them, you can kind of be a little bit familiar with it. The last type of design you'll see often, especially in the industries that are common now for chemical engineers to be working in. So fine chemicals, these are chemicals that cost hundreds of dollars per kilogram. Pharmaceuticals, food manufacturing, all the processing. They use mixture designs all the time. The principle being is you're optimizing a recipe. You cannot adjust your recipe independently. If there's three ingredients, so here I'm mixing orange juice, pineapple juice, and watermelon juice, I cannot adjust the three of them independently. They always need to add up to 100%. So there's that constraint. And so a mixture design says, well, I've got this constraint over here. This is due to acidity. I don't want my juice mixture to be too acid, so I cannot put any points in this region. This point over here would correspond to the 33%, 33, 33% blend of the three juices. So where do I place my experiments in this system to, say, maximize the taste or improve the taste to the highest degree possible while minimizing cost? Like, I can't have 100% watermelon juice. That's obviously the cheapest juice, but it's tasteless. So where do you place your designs in order to find them? So you'll see mixture designs, and you'll always see them using the triangles. So that's pretty much it for the DOE section. Next week is moving to the last section, which was a multivariate analysis. And just so you're aware of the assignments, so that's assignment 7. There will be an assignment for the newest stuff on DOE, but it's not for handles, just for you to practice for exams. In addition, on the website I put some previous exam papers from Dr. McGregor, he taught the course. I have a different style to him, so those questions are not my style. And they also cover, Dr. McGregor often went into more details on e-optimal design than I have published on this. So there will be another optional assignment for DOE, and the final assignment will be for multivariate data analysis. And that will be in a week or two's time only. So there's time for the courses and some of the other stuff. But those of you, remember that the grading for the assignments is such that I only take the 6 highest grades out of the 8 assignments. So some of you may decide not to even hand in a last assignment given the lows in the other courses. So it's entirely up to you.